All right, welcome everybody. This is Barney Kunze, and we're here live at the right time on the right day here. We had an interesting set of circumstances for those of you who knew that the call or thought that the call was yesterday on Boxing Day. We had a little bit of a mix-up, but it was a good thing because our guest presenter and speaker that's going to be joining us here, Dr. Christina, in a couple minutes, I think she'll be able to tell us a story, but she's like, oh my goodness, I got caught. I was out in the kayak and we couldn't get back in time. And so we debated on Jamie and I internally here at the Animal Wellness Summit. We debated on whether or not we should do a call this week or just take a break. But we thought, you know what? We're gonna do this. We're gonna keep doing our thing. And but nonetheless, we're here. We're ready. We're excited. So thank you for those of you who are here. You guys are in. And also, I'll say you're welcome. At the same time, which might sound kind of bizarre, but thank you for joining us and taking the time to be here live. But also, you're welcome in advance because I have a sense that this is going to be another phenomenal call. And just to restate what these are live weekly coaching calls that we do for free. We're facilitating them on behalf of the presenters who participated in our Animal Wellness Summit. Without them, we wouldn't have an event. And so these calls were set up for part of our paid membership program, our VIP and Platinum membership program. But we found that there was so much value and so much content that was being shared that the VIPs actually unanimously decided, hey, you know what, these really should be made available for everybody. And so now they have other type of training called monthly mini masterclasses, which are part of their paid membership. So you can thank the current members for making this free for you. So without further ado, we're going to bring in Dr. Christina Chambreau. And Dr. Christina, as I bring you in here, did I pronounce your name correctly?
You did great, Barney. Thank you.
Awesome. Welcome.
Only people from France and Quebec do it properly. Even I can't do it properly. So you did great, Chambreau.
Well, that's good. I did excel at my in my French classes in public school, but I never took it much further than that, just with being able to pronunciate some words. But let's first of all, where are you right now? And why don't you tell us a story about what happened yesterday? Because I thought it was kind of funny when I emailed you. I had this sinking feeling when I was away, and then I got the email because in my mind I had planned for it. Like last week, for those of the members who are here that were on last week, I had said, you know, okay, next call is going to be next week, December the 27th on Thursday. And then, but it ended up working out that it was good because you had, you're somewhere where you were kayaking, or what were you doing there?
Yes, I'm actually on a 2-week vacation over the holidays at, and pardon me for moving around. I just realized I have to plug in my computer. And we're down at a wonderful place called Longboat Key. And one of my favorite things to do at Longboat Key is to go kayaking. There's this couple who were raised in Longboat Key, and she's a marine biologist, and they're super committed to environmental, which I am. Sustainability is like as big to me as animal health is. And it all ties together because holistic animal health helps the environment and helps our planet. So I love this couple. And I went kayaking, and it was really windy. And I made the mistake of going downwind, going out, and I went too far. And then coming back up against the wind was like, oh no, I can't do it. I just can't do it.
Well, it worked out. It worked out. And you know what? The cool part is that the neat part is for those that can come on live, they get the benefit of being able to ask you questions, which, by the way, I know that some of you are probably leaving comments and or at least I think you are. But I, for whatever reason, sometimes this platform that we use called BeLive TV, it delays the comments. So if you guys could do me a favor, can you drop a comment? I just saw Brian Gallagher's comment show up there. So if anybody else has commented, just go and put like where you're calling in from or where you're listening. You're not calling in. I was with them, like, let us know where you're calling in from. But just let
Oh
us
yeah, where are you?
know, where are you tuning in live from? So let
Where's your
us know
body?
that. Where are you physically located on planet Earth? Yes.
Right. So I'm in Florida, in Naples, at the wonderful Ritz-Carlton Hotel.
Oh, cool.
I'm not staying here. I came down to visit some friends, and so they're generously letting me use their lobby.
Oh, that's nice. Well, it is the Ritz-Carlton after all, so I'm not surprised. okay, great. So there is some, so Kiko left.
We've got comments already.
Yeah, that's good. So they're coming in. So then that makes me feel good knowing that we have everything coming in nice and smooth and clean. So Dr. Christina, can you tell us a little bit more about you? I know that I have a sense that there's going to be quite a bit of people that know who you are in your story, but there's going to be a handful that don't.
Sure.
Have no idea who you are.
Absolutely. So I'm an Air Force brat. And I lived all over the world, and I graduated from the University of Georgia College of Veterinary Medicine in 1980. I was 30 years old and did not even know what a vegetarian was, much less anything about holistic health for animals. A year or two later, a client came in to a small clinic I was running all by myself and asked me to draw blood and send the results to a local veterinarian who did homeopathy. And I said, sure, I'll do that. What's homeopathy? And that was the beginning of the process. And I ended up, over the last 40 years, I've been speaking all around the world, Prague, Bali, Hong Kong, US, Canada. I've given courses. I've edited the Integrative Veterinary Care Journal. I've taught veterinary technicians. Actions Academy. And along Jeff Feynman and I, share the same commitment, and we've each had it individually for decades, which is my goal is to empower people to know that there are multiple healing options. This is so important because holistic veterinarians often get phone calls like this. I wish I had heard about you sooner. Why didn't I know about this? My commitment is to figure out ways to have people know. So I've asked people, well, how would you have known? Where would you have heard this? Because I'd make sure I'd fill that niche. And they would say, from my veterinarian. Well, that's a harder niche to fill. So I've been speaking at veterinary conferences like the AVMA and other veterinary conferences to get that point across. And what's happening with the internet is we have much more access, but people still are not hearing it enough. So for every one of you who's on this call, because you came here because you already listened to a week of wonderful holistic seminars, so you are holistic ambassadors, make sure you go to your conventional veterinarian once a year just for a physical and share all the wonderful things. Pay your money. Just consider it as promoting holistic veterinary medicine. And it's good to get a physical once a year from a veterinarian. Preferably a holistic one, but bring on those conventional veterinarians. Bring on everybody who you interact with. Even if they say, what? You feed raw meat? That's awful. Or you don't get a vaccine? No, of course not. So it's up to you to really be the ambassadors. And so that's been my goal. Initially, it was to make sure that people knew the basics. Now, most of you listening to this call got the basics this week from my talk, from Dr. Judy's talk, from multiple other people. And the basics are feed a fresh food diet, minimize toxins, and vaccines are not only full of toxins, but they trigger and weaken the immune system. Most importantly, don't suppress symptoms with holistic or conventional methods. The goal isn't to get rid of symptoms. The goal is to rebalance the underlying energy field balance. When it's balanced, it no longer produces symptoms. So that's the goal. Now, in the meantime, you can soothe symptoms, but you've got to always be going for a deep cure. And then, of course, physical and mental exercise. Especially people forget about cats. Cats are brilliant. They can actually do agility. They can do a high five. So work with your cat from day one. For your cat and your dog from day one, you also want them to love, not just like, not just accept, but to actually look forward to you doing examinations on them, to have them love brushing their teeth, looking in their ears, cleaning their eyes, and even taking their temperature. So that's a good start at the basics.
Yeah, that's anything? A really good. Yeah, no, it's really good. Yeah. No, I know that you probably definitely can. Can you actually tilt your screen a little bit more towards you? Yeah, there
this
you
way?
Go.
Okay. Yeah. Now, when I'm looking at it, it cuts off my head, but it's okay.
Yeah, that's cut off a little, maybe back a little bit now. Just because when I start adding in the yeah, that's good. Perfect, right there.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. Just because then when I add in the comments and the questions, mm-hmm. I won't yep. cut your head off. So that's pretty neat. So you've been in doing your line of work for how long now?
40 years.
Wow.
And teaching.
Yeah, that's pretty.
And I was a conventional working in a vet clinic kind of kid from the time I was 10, well, 11. So I've got like 20 years of conventional and 40 years of 38 years of holistic.
Right. Well, that's pretty awesome. And your presentations from the summit, because this is your first year presenting and you did two of them. So I have the Don't Settle for Better, Go for a Deep Cure and Longevity. And then the second one was Holistic Medical Decision-Making to Maximize Pet Health, which sounds so interesting. And I remember I went through them and now trying to remember the exact details of your presentation. I remember the one part where just thinking, I think it was the decision-making where it was just thinking, what came to me was about how it is, it can be really simple and you've got to keep it really simple and focus on the facts.
Well, the holistic medical decision-making is a really amazing process. And Dr. Jeff Feynman of the Holistic Actions Academy created this. So he taught it to me.
Yeah.
It's three steps, three simple steps. And what it will do when you practice it and adopt it, you will no longer feel pressured by your conventional veterinarian, your emergency veterinarian, your dog park friends to do something immediately. You won't be pressured to get rid of symptoms. You won't be pressured to give the vaccine or feed commercial food. Whatever things you're starting to explore, you won't be pressured because you'll learn how to think for yourself. And that's really important. A lot of people don't ask questions. Okay, my dog is having trouble walking and you say we need to do an X-ray and an MRI and a CAT scan. Wait a minute, why do we have to do all of those at one time? You said my dog had pancreatitis, treated it, he didn't respond, and now you say I have to take out his gallbladder surgically? Wait a minute, something's missing here. Too often people don't stop and ask those. They ask me, should I give heartworm prevention every month? And I go, well, how do dogs get heartworms? And they go, I don't know. Or they go from the stool or give other answers. Occasionally they know it comes from mosquitoes. So you need to ask questions. The three steps of the holistic medical decision-making is number one, set a goal. For most of us, we are being trained and brainwashed over and over and over again, day after day after day, TV commercial after TV commercial, to get rid of symptoms. Every ad is about stop the headache fast, stop the diarrhea fast, stop your tummy ache, stop, stop, stop. Well, sometimes you do need to stop a symptom. There are times when a dog is, or cat's life is in jeopardy. And you do need oxygen. You may need surgery. You may need, like when a dog is bloating, if the homeopathic remedy you gave on the way to the vet did not work, you may need surgery right away. But you still have 5 minutes that you can stop and think, wait a minute, maybe I can call my homeopathic veterinarian and try one more remedy. Nope, that won't work. I know that my dog is really blue. And I better do just what the conventional vet says. So step one is set a goal. Is it to emergency get rid of the symptoms? Or is it to rebalance the energy field so that the symptoms they go away The body heals the symptoms itself, and more importantly, they never come back. So the second step is to do research. The best research is your animal's symptoms. So learning to do physical exams on your animals is very important. In the respiratory course, for instance, at Holistic Actions Academy, we put together a home respiratory exam. In the heart seminar, we put together a home heart health exam where we actually teach you how to, probably smear my lipstick here, but that's okay, how to look at the gum color, how to do capillary refill by pressing. It turns white. How fast does it turn pink again? How to actually feel the heart, how to feel the pulse, and maybe if you're good, be able to feel the heart rate and the pulse rate at the same time, unless you have maybe a great name and or a cat that's hard to feel. So learning how to do these physical exams is really important. That's number one in research. Number two in research is to create a healing team of people that you can go to. It might be animal trainers, behavior. It might be a holistic veterinarian or several holistic veterinarians. Maybe you have one that does acupuncture, one that does chiropractic or osteopathy, one that does homeopathy. It might be a masseuse. It might be somebody who's an expert in essential oils and knows how to use the oils. And these will, they may give you differing opinions, but all you're doing right now is research. You're not taking action yet. So you're making a list of everything that you're learning. Then you go to Dr. Google and you go on the internet and you do internet searches and you read and you listen and maybe you stumble on the Animal Summit tapes and you listen to them and that, you know, you're adding that to your research. And you have your own computer that you've downloaded all these wonderful courses onto and you pay attention there. Or you're a member of the Holistic Actions Academy and you are on a weekly Empower Hour webinar with Dr. Feynman and myself, and you ask your questions there. So there's multiple approaches to collect that research, but you do, particularly on the internet, of course, everybody knows this, right? You got to be careful.
Yeah.
It's not always good information. But more importantly, from all those sources of information, you have to remember that there are multiple different ways that can help animals. Each way does not help every animal. So I missed the name, but the person whose dog just died of congestive heart failure.
Kevin. I'll put it back up.
Kevin. Okay. So Kevin, I'm so sorry that your dog died. And part of healing is sometimes death. Sometimes, regardless of you think you're doing all the quote right things, not vaccinating, feeding your fresh food diet, not suppressing symptoms, giving exercise, all of that, and animals still get really sick, just like people. There are people who are vegetarians, vegans, macrobiotic, exercising, doing it all right, and they get cancer and die at age 25. So there is no right way to do things. We're all on a journey of health. And actually, one of the big gifts that our animals give us is the gift of creating our own philosophy about death and grieving. So some people, when their animals die, are devastated and may never get another animal again. Others are really devastated and sad and eventually move through it. Others see death as a transition to another wonderful time. And many even know that their animals may come back in a different form and be with them again and totally know they've had that happen. Others just know, wow, we don't know what the answer is. What happens to us when we pass? But it's something good. So in a way, we celebrate when they go, even while we miss them being around. So there are things you can do to research and learn ways to keep your animals healthier, all the things talked about in the summit. No one of you can do all of those things on one animal. It's just, it's an impossibility time-wise, but also it'd be confusing for the animal. So as you go back and review from the summit, find things that grab you, that you're interested in. Make a plan. Number one, add fresh food to the diet 3 times a week. Number two, begin using essential oils for behavior issues. Number three, start probiotics and digestive enzymes. Then decide how long you're going to give between each one. Don't do them all at one time, because then what worked? You don't know what made the difference. So start with one and then keep track of what changed. How did the symptoms change? So the third step is to pause, wait a minute, think, decide, make a plan, and then take action. Part of taking action is evaluating the response to the treatment you've chosen. That's really important. Yeah, so Kevin says that there were signs of congestive heart failure, which he didn't know. Even if you knew, it may not have made a difference. And now you'll know and be more informed for the future. And that's what, when people, for instance, get the course from the Holistic Actions Academy on congestive heart failure, they learn the breeds that are more susceptible to having heart problems, and a test that can be done proactively to tell if there's a problem that may be appearing in the future. It measures how the heart's doing. So there are things that you can learn. And so every animal that we get better. Every month that we're alive and try new things on ourselves, we learn more things. And remember, again, the other piece of the internet research is, for any one treatment, every treatment out there on the internet says, my animal was cured overnight. This, my animal's been fine ever since I did this. This has been a magic for me. It's just not for every animal. It's not that they're lying. They're telling the truth. It's just, it helped them, right? Not everybody. So that's really an important key.
Yeah, well, really, really, really good. I'll give you a break for a second. I want to comment on something. So thank you for sharing that with Kevin. Kevin and Wendy are platinum members from the state somewhere. I can't remember what state they live in, but I remember him and his wife have joined together. So that's, you know, Kevin, I just want to pull that up for a second because I think this is important. Just really, you know, Dr. Christina, with what you had said, like, you know, there might not have been anything that he could have or they could have done or did. I always get mixed up whether I should say could have did or could have done. It always corrects me and then I second guess myself. But now I think that what I've learned through myself going through this, like, we lost our dog, Lucy, this year. And she just ran away and we didn't know what happened. And we believe that she just ran away and transitioned, as Brent Atwater would say. And, you know, ran away to die, as others would say. And it really caught me off guard. And then my wife was feeling guilty and she should have did this and maybe I should have did that and all this stuff. And then I think now that we've had a break from having a little dog in our house, it's been cute watching our girls see the dogs at my sister's place and them like, oh, like, they're just cuddling with them and then asking and then seeing. And my point with bringing this up with for Kevin, based on what you said, is that there's sometimes, you know, doesn't matter what we do when it's our time or their time, that's it, you know. And I mean, I've been in the holistic health field for the humans for the last 15 to 17 years myself. I know that there's people that will come to me, and I specialize in holistic health and corrective exercise. And people will say, oh, well, I tried this diet or that diet or this workout regime and it didn't work. And I'm like, well, because everybody's biochemically individually unique and we have this similar makeup and construction, but everybody responds to oils differently, to different, you know, diet. And so there's, the best thing that I learned from my coach was learning how to pay attention to the results of what it is that we're doing. And I love that what you said about not just implementing all this stuff. Because we would have a questionnaire that I would, like, if you came to me as a client, I would take you through a questionnaire and then there'd be, you know, 17 different things on there that really could be or should be addressed. But we picked the most three, the top three that they're most probable to do. And then we take action on those first and then move through them. So I think it's really cool. And I think the other thing that just to comment on Kevin is just saying that that's neat where, you know, now that Kevin's been learning, going through the presentations and now he knows, well, now, you know, you can be better prepared for the next one, right?
Right.
You know, it's not going to be the real one.
Now, I want to speak a moment about what you just said, Barney, in terms of knowing what changes. In homeopathy, so I'm trained as a classical homeopath. I want to make sure people recognize homeopathy is holistic, but all holistic is not homeopathy. Sometimes people confuse the two, especially since some products are improperly sold as homeopathic. And it's not really, homeopathic is not about the product as much as it is matching the energy fields. And so through homeopathy, we've learned there are four responses to any treatments at all. One is nothing happens. You're off base. Just doesn't happen. Doesn't resonate. Two is what we see a lot is suppression. You give a drug. It might even be an essential oil. It could be a homeopathic medicine. And the symptom goes away. The ear problem, the itching stops. And then there's a deeper, worse change like cancer or digestive problems or behavior problems. And that means you cause suppression. The body has quit and now it's responding, but it can't get it out to the skin again. It's going to more serious organs. Much even more common is palliation or amelioration of symptoms. That's where you have to keep treating. So essential oils are wonderful, but I see a lot of people, they have an animal with a behavior problem and they pick an essential oil, they begin to give it, there's an improvement, and they keep giving the essential oil. And when they stop the essential oil, the behavior problem is still there. They haven't done the training that's necessary in addition to, or they haven't discovered the homeopathic medicine that's needed. They haven't gone to a homeopathic veterinarian to see what's needed to fix the underlying problem that's causing it. Other times you can give an essential oil for a few days or a week and the problem's completely gone and it stays gone and they get healthier overall. So that's our goal, is a cure. The symptoms go away in a time appropriate way. If they've been scratching for 3 years, it shouldn't go away in 5 minutes. It should take a few months to go away. It'll get better, but not gone. Symptoms go away and they feel better. What we call the early warning signs of illness go away. They stop having goop in the corner of their eyes. Cats stop vomiting hairballs. They stop eating weird things or licking pictures. They cats who are not on dry food stop drinking water. Dogs have better behavior and don't have anal gland problems. These are all early clues that the energy field is out of balance. And their beam is good. Their behavior, their energy, their mood and their appetite are all good. So those are the three ways: cure, palliation, and suppression, and nothing. Our goal, the goal is not really to focus on just one thing, but to use all the symptoms as a clue to what's needed to fix this energy field.
What's the root?
Now, sometimes we're far down the line. Jan Uecker, do you want to put that one up? Has a golden retriever that has cancer, been on chemotherapy, and is now developing renal disease. So feeding a good diet is great. It depends on the level of the kidney disease as to what percent protein should be fed, but fresh meat, raw or slightly cooked, is important. And each animal is different in terms of what they need, in terms of the vegetables and the protein. You can watch the thirst level, the energy level, to see if what you're feeding seems to be helping. Remember, there's no one right answer. That's a real important takeaway from here. The second thing, Jan, is I would, as soon as you can, and you're in Chicago, so there are a number of great holistic veterinarians there that can work with you along with the chemotherapy. Or Dr. Charles Loops is a homeopath in North Carolina who does phone consulting for animals that are with cancer. And he's okay when they're on chemotherapy. He also works with them. Madison, Wisconsin, there are a bunch of holistic vets in the Chicago area. So I would definitely start with that immediately to help prevent further deterioration with the renal disease. But the diet itself may not be enough. You might want to get from your chiropractor or from your holistic veterinarian a standard process supplement called canine renal support. If you're working with an animal with a essential oil practitioner, they'd be able to suggest oils that could help. But again, in addition to those, I would really be doing either homeopathy or very good traditional Chinese veterinary medicine, abbreviated TCVM.
Yeah.
The way to find out how to make fresh food diets is everywhere these days. Oh no, you say. It's everywhere. What do I do? Number one, reprogram your mind. This is very important.
What were you saying? What's everywhere?
Everywhere is opinions on how to make fresh food.
Yeah.
Just like for people. How many opinions are there about how you should eat? There's mm-hmm. the medical medium, there's paleo diet, there's keto diet. And how do you decide what you as a person should eat? Like you were saying earlier, Barney, people come to you saying, I've tried every diet. Well, there is no one right diet. So the reprogramming of your mind that's critical here is too many people say, okay, processed pet food isn't good. It's got bad stuff in it. So I'm going to duplicate what's in the processed food with fresh food. No. Mm-hmm. Here's what you want to think. I have a carnivore cat. I have an omnivore dog. What do they eat in the wild? What are their teeth like? What do their teeth need to stay healthy? What's their stomach like? How does their digestion work? And then you give them the same quality ingredients that you get. If you go to a farm and you find organic, sustainably raised, natural, humanely treated animals that are being raised and organic vegetables, and that's what you buy, that's what your animals eat. If you go to the grocery store, then you buy grocery store food for your animals, unless your animals are really ill, and then you may want to allocate some of your medical budget to buy higher quality food than you can afford for yourself. So that's number one. You're looking at what do they eat in the wild. There's some great books out there. Barbara Royals is a good one. We have Karen Becker's healthy food, natural food for healthy dogs and cats. We have Dr. Ihor's Ancient Wisdom, Fresh Food and Ancient Wisdom, talking about the Chinese medicine approach to feeding. Dr. Judy Morgan, who spoke on the summit. Yeah. So definitely go to the summit talks and then pursue it from there. My website, which is myhealthyanimals.com, or my name, ChristinaChambreau.com, has a resources tab. Then you go to my favorite books. Then you go to nutrition. And I've commented on different books. So you can see what's sort of in those books and decide what to get. But any amount of fresh feeding is an improvement. Okay.
Yeah. Dr. Christine, can I comment on this? Are you familiar with Dr. Ruth? Wow, completely drawn a blank.
I'm drawing a blank on Ruth.
This is so unfair. The original crock pet diet.
Actually, Jeff Feynman's wife is really big on crock pot recipes.
Okay.
And so on the Holistic Actions Forum, we talk a lot about crock pot feeding. I prefer if people feed a raw meat diet. Yeah. However, it's fine to do crock pot some of the time and raw meat some of the time. But in the wild, no animal pulls out a match, builds a fire, plugs in a crock pot, puts the ingredients in it, and then cooks it.
Yeah.
So it's better than processed.
Yeah. What's interesting, the reason Dr. Ruth Roberts, I was embarrassed.
Okay. Ruth Roberts.
It was very interesting. There was a call where, and my sister actually had a problem with her dog with some yeast, and she was feeding, and he was just itchy, always having these problems. And she was feeding him raw, like she's into studying homeopathy and doing as much as she could, and just kept persisting. And then she started the Crock-Pot diet, and it went away. And the way, because Ruth has designed it, and from the TVCM or the traditional Chinese, mm-hmm. it was pretty interesting. Which I thought, yeah, for sure, like raw is like the king. But you know, she said some animals, as you said before, by the result, some just can't do it. So
that's
anyways, I just wanted to comment on that. But that was really great. A great answer.
And Brian actually has a good follow-up question on this.
Yeah.
So Brian, here's the thing, and for everybody, anytime there's a problem, step one of the HMDM is set your goal. So your goal in this case is, do I have to go to a veterinarian right away? Okay, so you look at not just one symptom, he's eating way more than usual, but you look at how is he feeling overall? What's his beam? Behavior, other than appetite, behavior, energy, and mood. If all of those are good, he's active, he's playful, he's behaving normally. If all of that is fine, then you don't have to rush to the veterinarian. So that's number one. Number two, you do some research and you think, you look at the food you've been feeding and you think, what about this wet food I've been feeding? Has there been a change in that brand? Have they changed what they're doing? And maybe that's affecting his appetite. Am I exercising him more? So you look at the context of how he's doing. And my gut reaction for you is to not go right to the vet, but pay attention to what's happening. I would not leave wellness in the bowl. I would never, for any animal, well, I take that back. In most situations, I would not leave food out. Animals need to have some, they smell so much, especially cats, that if the food is in the house, they smell it. So they always stay in a digestion mode, never an assimilation, never a good assimilation mode. They don't get to get hungry. So I know he's hungry all the time, but maybe feed him four times a day already. So maybe add an extra meal rather than leaving food out all the time. But pay attention to those other symptoms. And I would then go to, if it persists, then I would immediately contact a holistic veterinarian and find a good holistic veterinarian to work with. If you go, again, at my website, I have on the resources page, you go to links. And under links, there's a section on working with veterinarians, how to select a veterinarian, how to work with them, and a list of all of the different organizations that veterinarians can belong to. So you can find somebody near you, or go to the Academy of Veterinary Homeopathy website, because homeopathic veterinarians can help you by telephone. There are a few other holistic veterinarians that can help by telephone as well. So since his behavior is good, you have time. You don't have to rush. Okay, Eva Marie, the answer to your question, the first answer is what Barney said originally. Different animals, different people need different things. So you say you've done all the right things from the book, but the cat and the kitten don't get along together. So yes, I would recommend Bach flower essences. I would recommend essential oils or hydrosols. I would recommend any of the essential oils, particularly Jackson Galaxy's spirit essences. They have one called Safe Space, and they also have some for introduce. They have a lot of cat behavior, foster, kennel, shelter kind of essences. Flower essences are 100% safe. There's also Anaflora flower essences, and those can be, those also, she has some there for bringing animals, new animals home. And back to the food issue, if you're having food problems, any of you, the Pet Essences Company, I think is the one, has a flower essence to help animals transition to fresh food that don't seem to want to eat fresh food. The other thing is that some cats really just want to be solitary And so you're just going to have to, you may have to end up having different places in the house for them. I knew of one cat, of one family, where they had cat A, perfectly fine, active, playful, wonderful, and then they got cat B. Cat A was still healthy, but just wasn't itself. But they thought it was just getting older. And then for some reason, cat B got injured 5, 6, 8 years later and died. And all of a sudden, cat A was back to the healthy, fabulous, out there personality. So sometimes, you know, it's just not what they want. Working with animal intuitives could be useful. Barney, did we have intuitive talks on the Animal Summit?
Yeah, we did.
Good. So I would using, and so Eva Marie, first step, call an animal intuitive. Well, first step, listen to the animal intuitive talk on the Animal Wellness Summit and then give them a buzz.
Yeah.
And are there any particular EOs that you would recommend, Barney, for two cats not getting along?
Well, you know what? That's, I would suggest, with the cats, I don't know as much.
Okay.
My experience is mainly with the with dogs, and I know there's still quite a bit of controversy over the cats and oils. I know that a lot of it has to do with quality, but there's some that you do want to shy away from. But what I would suggest, so for them, Eva Maria, if you did want to, there's Dr. Carol Commoner. I'm not sure if she's a doctor or not.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, she is.
Okay.
Oh no, she's not. No.
The Healing Touch for Animals. Okay. And the course on
Karen.
That. Yeah,
oh, no, you're right. It's Carol.
Yeah, Carol.
Karen.
And then
yeah, Carol.
Allie Phillips, she did a presentation on using essential oils for pets in pet shelters. And she talks a lot. There was actually, if you go on our Facebook page and then go on her Facebook page and then search for cats essential oils in the controversy. There was a very good call with two of the presenters on talking about the different perspectives. But in short, I would say what you suggested is perfect. And I think that she had put a question up a little further, but maybe not.
And there were some other good comments on working with animal pet whisperers and how that helped. And so
yeah.
That is good. The other thing that I'm not...
follow-up question from
leave Eva's up there for me. The other thing that's really good is to everybody should learn Reiki. Everybody should get attuned to Reiki or some other energy method like Theta Healing Reconnective Therapy, all the other ones that are out there, Bengston method. Reiki is readily available, and that's why I encourage that. If you sit in your home every day, regardless of how many people and animals are in your home, you sit there and you offer Reiki to all living beings in the house. And you do it for 10 minutes or 20 minutes, and it will prevent a lot of diseases and can often help. And don't worry if the animals leave the room. They're still getting it. They're just more sensitive and don't want to be right by you while you're giving it.
Yeah,
so Eva Marie, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say that's great, and I didn't mean to cut you off. I was just going to say before... Megan Aro, her last name's AYRAULT. She has a free course on touch, like for doing that and doing Reiki or touch with animals. And then Carol Commoner, the Healing Touch for Animals. It's amazing work. I would let you.
Yep. And healing, the one difference there is Healing Touch with Animals, mostly you're working with each individual animal. The nice thing about Reiki is you can offer it for everybody at one time, which is really cool.
Yes.
So for Eva Marie, step one is get rid of the dry. If she's eating any wet at all, get rid of the dry. So if I could have my way on my tombstone, it would say during her life, dry food ceased to be manufactured in the world. That's how bad dry food is for cats.
Yeah.
Now, having said that, there are cats I know that live to be 20, 25 on dry food. Everybody's unique. But cats' kidneys just really suffer with dry food. So first, Eva Marie, get rid of the dry. Number two, start adding just a teeny bit, even if it's
Oh, are you still there? All right, I think we might have lost Dr. Christina. Hopefully she comes back. Let me just pull this back out. So I want to comment on this and let me just give me 1 second. I'm going to refresh this my screen, and hopefully Dr. Christina will come back. All right, I think that is a sign that her internet cut out. That's not good, but I want to comment on this for a second. Where is it? So she was talking about, feeding raw, and Eva Maria, you had said that, you know, you find it complicated. So that I will admit that we found that too when we started to do some of that with Lucy. And to be honest, we found the crockpot diet, the original crockpot diet by Dr. Ruth Roberts, very, very good, because it is still raw food. You're just cooking it low temperature in a crock pot, and then you freeze it, and then you get it out the night before, and you're feeding your cats or your dogs whole food. And we felt really good about that. And budget-wise, it's actually really, really good. So it might even be a step up for you to start there instead of going straight to raw. But then again, I'm not the expert. I'm in the same boat as you guys are. But I just wanted to comment on that. The other thing though is Dr. Erin O'Connor. She's an animal chiropractor from Naperville, Illinois, in Chicago. And she has her presentation in the summit is on like getting started with feeding raw. And she makes some really great suggestions there. So if you're a member, I'm not sure if you are, Eva Maria, but if you are, I would suggest it to anybody else listening to go check out those presentations that we've mentioned. And I will do my best to come back, cause I saw that, where was it? Kevin was asking if we could post the link. So Kevin, just leave a comment for me and let me know, were you referring to, Dr. Christina's, website or some of the other ones that she was mentioning, or all of them? If you can just be more specific and let me know. But I think the one that I did post was her website, Dr. Christina's website. And she's back. She looks like she's getting situated. Do you give me a thumbs up there? Are you good to go? Okay. This is what happens on a live sometimes. But you're back.
I'm back. But let's see. Let me get the chat up again.
Yeah, that's okay. Well, you're getting that up. I was just answering a couple things and saying that Dr. Erin O'Connor, she's an animal chiropractor from Naperville, Illinois, so in Chicago. So who else were we talking to that was from Chicago? That was, pardon me, I think it was Jane. Jane's from Chicago.
Yes, finding bribe foods is really important. That's one of the things with helping cats eat. And yeah, that's why as soon as you get a cat in the house, start feeding them all sorts of different fresh food. Doesn't matter if you think it's good for them or not. Feed them anything. Let them try some ice cream, some yogurt, some pizza. I know pizza isn't what dogs should eat, but if you discover that, I had one cat that every time it was ill, it was a client's cat, it would eat broccoli and cauliflower. A cat. And yet once you discover that, then you know you have a variety of different things that you can feed.
Right.
That's and you can use certainly as a topper. Now, if you have a cat that is totally addicted to dry food, one of the things that you can do as you're switching them over is take the dry food and put it in a coffee grinder or herb grinder and grind it into a fine powder. Then you put down a little bit of the new food. Don't go, you know, try some raw, try some canned, and sprinkle, like salt, a little bit of that dry food on top, because that's what they're used to. And the odor gets them started, and then they finish eating. But never that, so that'll often help transition them.
Yeah.
Oh, good. That was for Betty Ann. She was just talking about that.
Yeah, and that, and Jan, I was just going to comment, Jan from Chicago, I would look up Dr. Erin O'Connor, because exactly, she's heard she's amazing. And I feel like she would be a great resource for you based on what Dr. Christina is sharing. And this one here from Tina Austin, this is a big one.
Mm-hmm. So here's the thing. Feeding animals raw does change some of their blood values. They can be a little bit higher. We talk about this on our veterinary listservs a whole lot. And so you have to look not at one enzyme, but you look at all of the enzymes. I would not, and not just the liver ones, but everything, all the blood work. And you look at all the symptoms, including the early warning signs and the BEAM symptoms. I've never had an animal really become ill over time on a well-prepared raw food diet. I would try, what I might try doing, the thing about commercial raw food diets is you're sort of replacing the pet food again. You're thinking pet food, but with fresh ingredients, as opposed to what are they eating in the wild. So maybe try doing your own food or change the brand and feed a different brand every few weeks. See if that changes that. Now, certainly being on a milk thistle is good, but it would be important at this point to make sure to go to a TCVM veterinarian or a homeopathic veterinarian, so that they can help you with this evaluation to see if that's a critical problem or not. And Tina, good name. I was Tina until I was 30.
That's great. Okay, this one, I think this is a real quick one. Well, pretty straightforward.
They can all eat the same diet. Absolutely. So think about this. Again, the question is, what do they eat in the wild? Do one-year-olds eat different kinds of meat than 10-year-olds? Well, a 10-year-old who has bad teeth might go more for the organ meat or the softer meat, and they might not eat the ears, for instance, that are more tough. And the one-year-old may do fine with eating the ears. But in general, with us feeding food, you don't have to worry about it. Now, they can all eat the same diet as long as they're all relatively healthy. Certainly, if any one of them has a particular problem, then you have to look to see, like Ihor Basco's book, Fresh Food and Ancient Wisdom, do you need to tweak it with Chinese medicine? Or do you need to go to a crockpot cooking? Or do you, you know, so, but the quick answer is yes, feed them the same.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, this one from Stina Kennedy in upstate New York.
Yep, absolutely.
Now, do you have a resource for that? Because I feel like...
Yep, I actually said that. So if you go to my website,
yes,
and then click on the resources tab, under the resources tab is a link page. On the link page, at the very beginning, I mean, it's got a whole list of what's on the link page, but the first item on the link page is a list of all of the veterinary organizations. If you're in upstate New York, and I think halfway, but like in the middle of the state, upstate New York, check out Cynthia Lankenau, Lankenau. She's amazing. And she's in multiple of the organizations. And if there is no, but, and I know there's a scattering, they're not a lot in upstate New York, but there are some. Now, one of the things that you say, Stina, is very, very important. I wish there were a true holistic vet near me. One of the problems and one of the issues is a lot of the websites you'll go to, like the AHVMA website, people may have joined the AHVMA, taken one course or come to one conference and gone, I'm not going to do this, but they're still listed there. So you need to go to the veterinary clinic website. You need to read about them. And all of this is in my Selecting and Working with a Holistic Veterinarian. So I coach you through that. Oh, by the way, before we finish,
yeah,
that is what I do now. I'm no longer being the homeo. So I hope that answers Stina's. So you're doing fine. Premolars will fall out sometimes. I'm sorry, they just will. and even on raw fed dogs. I would be careful on the raw bones so you're not feeding. I would do like turkey necks. I wouldn't do marrow bones or femurs. That would be the main thing. But there's some imbalance going on to have that happen. So again, you need to approach the holistic vet, and homeopaths work by phone. So I used to be a phone call homeopathic veterinarian. Yeah. When I turned 65, I stopped doing that, and I do pet health coaching. So any of you can contact me through my email or website. The email, if you could type it in, Barney, is healthyanimals@aol.com. And we start off with a holistic prognosis. Then we talk about what you've already been doing, what you can do at home that's 100% safe. And that would go really quickly if you've already done the summit, because you've learned most of it on the summit. But we'll triage it. We'll make it for your animal's problem. And then I will match you up with a holistic veterinarian. So I actually, you and I will decide if you want osteopathy, chiropractic, et cetera. And I will match you up with them. If you're not happy with them, you get back to me and we work with somebody. We find you somebody else. So that's what I'm doing in terms of pet health coaching, in addition to the Holistic Actions Academy. If you decide to join the Holistic Actions Academy, which is holisticactions.com, if you drop me an email at healthyanimals@aol.com and say, I'm joining, I'll send you a free ebook.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay.
So where was the website?
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Holisticactions.com.
Okay. Okay. So yeah, so that's great, because I know we get, we as in the Animal Wellness Summit, we receive quite a bit of quite a few emails that come in, and then we direct them to the presenter that we know based on their training and education. But that's really the neat part in a nutshell, why what we do is kind of unique and why we're all here to work together, right? Is that you have specialties in areas that maybe some of the other presenters don't, or somebody like, wow, I just really love Dr. Christina. She's really cool. And and I'm not just saying that on Facebook Live. Because I think that it's important. It's great that you, all the wealth of your and knowledge you've gained over the short 40-year span of your career, that people can email you and do a consult. And, you know, that's where we, for our VIP membership, we set it up where that you can ask them these questions. And then for less than $1 a day, we set it up that way. And why it's just so neat. So that I'm going to leave that up here for you.
And I'd love to do one of your member webinars that you're doing for the VIP.
Say that again.
I would love to do a presentation, a workshop for your VIPs, so we can talk about that later.
Yeah, the mini masterclasses.
Mini masterclass, yes.
Did you hear about our live event that we're doing in the new year?
Yes, I did, and I'd love to be up there.
Yeah, well,
let me know. Jamie didn't know about it yet, but.
He doesn't until the stuff is final, because she's like, I don't know, even half the stuff Barney tells me is going to happen, it doesn't. And then stuff that I don't tell her about happens. But that's why I have her. She's the details queen.
So for everybody, what's important is keep checking in. Keep checking the website. Make sure you stay up with all the wonderful things that Barney's planning and doing and actually scheduling.
Yeah. Well, the summit is we're setting the dates for next year in the fall. And then we've had so many requests, and we do these Facebook Lives and they're amazing. They're awesome. You're in Florida. I'm in Canada. There's people in Denmark that was on in the UK. Sarah's in the UK. There's people all over the States. Tina Austin's in Ontario. And so it's cool that we can be connected, but I think there's this underlying need for being together and having some live training. And so it's going to be great. But
just a 2-second one, we're going to be doing a live training with the Holistic Actions Academy with me in Connecticut. I don't have the date on top of my head, but I think it's March. And it's going to be a 2-day introduction to homeopathy and vitality balance and the holistic medical decision making. So I agree with you that live is important. Most of the year we're online, but live is important. So head to Canada, everybody.
What's that?
I said everybody should head to Canada for the live event.
Well, especially for those of you in the States, I was joking and saying you bring $100 and you can live like a queen up here or a king, as a joke. But it is. It's one for every dollar that you bring in from the U.S. dollar, it gives you $1.30 Canadian right now.
So that means you get a lot of loonies and toonies.
That's right. You get a lot of loonies and toonies. This one, Betty Ann, we kind of skipped over this one somehow.
Oh, okay.
But or did
Well,
you?
that was I actually was addressing that when I talked about making a powdered of taking the dry kibble and powdering it.
Right.
The other thing is do not leave the dry kibble down because then they don't get hungry. A good book to help with this was from back in the 80s and been republished multiple times is by Anitra Fraser, The Natural Cat. It was The Natural Cat, and then she had a version, The New Natural Cat, and then it was back to Natural Cat. And she helps you. I think she's been a cat for the last 10 genera 10 lifetimes because she speaks cat. And so she will help, you know, and she does consulting too, or used to. I think she still does. But really, just use a little powdered. And that's one of the things that I can help with, as well as some of the other Animal Summit people can
Yeah.
help with, is coaching you on getting them to shift. I promise they can shift. New
Yeah.
Zealand has some wonderful integrated veterinarians there. Lisa Schneider, I may be pronouncing it wrong, but Lisa Schneider in New Zealand is a leader in the holistic field, number one. Number two, via the US, if you go to the homeopathic website, which is theavh.org, CIVT.com, or there's several, but it's all on my website. And or email
Okay.
me and we'll work on that. And I want to come to New Zealand, Lynn. So have me come teach there.
Oh, yeah, it's a great way. See, Lynn, in here the whole time you're thinking, man, there's not much in New Zealand, and now Dr. Christina might be coming down and doing
And
some
there's
teaching
actually a
for you.
number of good holistic vets down there. Now, I don't
Yeah.
know if they're North Island or South Island. I'm not sure about that.
So, okay, so this is where I think I have the sense that we're probably going to need to bring you on again for another call because this has been fabulous.
Oh, good. Okay,
Yeah,
I'd love to.
it's really good because I think that, and I can, I mean, everybody, a lot of comments. I know there's been 30 or 40 people on here live. And the neat part is once this is finished as a recording and we put it on our YouTube channel and then we put it on the members area so that you can see it. And we've made them so that we haven't done this yet. We will be doing this in January. We're getting the whole structure set up for the back end, but we're making it more like their blog posts so that they're easier to share. So then Dr. take this and just take the link and then it'll have all the recordings on there. Because right now it's been kind of gated or protected for just members. But we want to make it easier and easier. So it's great for you with all the resources that you're sharing and your website, because then you get more what we call digital footprint. And for everybody else, it's great because then I know that some of you guys are watching, you're like, oh my goodness, like I have to share this with Billy and Mary and Susie and Jane. And then you can just take that link and share it with them. Now, so that was great for Lynn. And then
And also, thank you, Tricia, for your share. I know, Lynn, you read that. Tricia said that it can take a year to switch a stubborn cat, like I said, a molecule at a time. And she
yes.
switched lots of cats to wet and then raw, and none of them eat dry food. Yes, Tricia, congratulations. And truly, anybody can do that.
That's awesome. Well, Lynn said absolutely. So maybe you're going to be going to New Zealand. Now, Pam, can you clarify for me, are you talking about what resources? Are you asking about the VIP membership for Animal Wellness Center? Or were you asking about, you said, how do we join? Because that could mean many different things. There was a couple of things that Dr. Christina mentioned.
Well, let's answer both of them. Barney, how do people join as a VIP member?
So you just go to Animal Wellness Summit. I'll post the link up there for you. And you just go to animalwellnesssummit.com and then just go to join. Or it might say buy the summit still, because we're getting out of the launch mode. And if you
And
have any questions about it, you can just email us at support at fullcircleholistichealth.com. I will put the email down there as well. We do have phone support involved in regular business hours at 1-877-577-7544. And then what were you
And
talking
for Holistic Actions, if you want to become a member of Holistic Actions, go to the website, holisticactions.com. Check that out. And there's a become a member or member benefits, explore member benefits. And if you like what you see, click how do you join and then send me an email at Healthy Animals and say you've joined. So I know you're there and the, it was someone I talked to today, and I'll send you a free ebook.
Awesome. Okay, well, I'll put that in.
And it's very similar as Barney's taught, you know, Barney's saying his, we're doing these membership sites because we want to ongoingly support people. We don't want it to be a one-time thing. And we know that, yes, you've watched the summit, but you still need, you're inundated by TV and other people. So you need that support often daily or weekly or at least monthly to stay the course.
Yeah.
So that's what we're both up to.
For sure. Yeah, that, and that, exactly. And that's where, so yeah, she was talking about VIP, and I know there were some other people asking about the holistic actions. So this is the thing is, when we did the summit the first time, usually summits are done as like a one, they're like you, the material gets put together and then it gets presented and then you either see it free, or you buy it. And then after that, it's gone. Not that it's gone, but if you buy it, then you have it. And if you have it, we're able to access it free. But what we were finding is that people were like, I went through it free, or I'm a member and I couldn't get through all the content. So like Tina Austin, I know is a VIP, Kevin, I think Kevin, yes, Kevin Haney, and his wife Wendy are members. And it's just neat because it's like drinking from a fire hose when you go through the summit. Now we haven't done this lately, but we don't have the setup yet, but for those of you who are coming here that you're like, well, I missed both of the summits, I don't even know what Dr. Christina talked about in both of her presentations, and I'm not sure if I want to join as a VIP, we're going to be setting up a short 48-hour little pass that you can kind of just jump in and take a look around and see all of the material, and then decide if you want to join. But on the other hand, if you join as a VIP, there's a 15-day money back guarantee. But I can tell you, we've never had anybody join and then request a refund because they weren't happy. That's usually a pretty good sign. So yeah, so this is great. I will post the link for the VIP membership. And Dr. Christina, there was more questions that we had emailed in. So for those of you who, well, they were emailed in and I didn't put them up on the screen.
Oh, got it. Okay.
Maybe what we'll do is we'll do another call in the next month or so and we can go through those questions. But did you have any kind of closing words of wisdom beyond that which you shared with us today?
Ask questions. Be your pet's advocate. Keep sharing all of your information and what works for you, realizing that everybody is an individual. Some dogs and cats need conventional treatment. Some need homeopathy, some need acupuncture, some need a combination. So you're in charge, and simply pay attention, and most of all, just be in the moment like they are and love and cherish them and know that the more holistic you do, the better you're helping our planet. No drug resistance in froggies and mutating froggies. Essential oils and homeopathy doesn't cause that.
Yeah, and I really love what you said about before about just that, you know, I saw this in being holistic health as well, and even some people with essential oils, they use it just like a drug, where it's kind of like the symptom, they take it to kind of get rid of a symptom, and there's a reason that your body has symptoms or that our animal have the symptoms, because they're telling a story about what's going on. And I think that the challenging part is that we've been conditioned, and when I say we collectively as a modernized society, not just in the Western world, to rely on somebody else to give us the answers. And even though we don't individually, as in Barney Kunze, have the answers, there is the intuition that we have, our innate intelligence that God has given us to use, but then having guidance from a skilled an educated and experienced person like yourself is also extremely valuable. So thank you for your time. And I do want to post this last thing up from Kevin. This is great, Kevin. Thank you for sharing. So you just said I recommend everyone sign up with the AWS. It's been worth it. There's lots of information there, so you have to sort through what applies, which is very true because there's over 130 presentations in there now. And then watch and learn from the experts. And then we have these weekly coaching calls. And then, as Dr. Christina said, we are doing monthly mini masterclasses. So there's going to be a specific topic that will come up. So then we'll decide on what your topic's going to be or your presentation. And then it's intended to be like you want to learn more about this topic, whatever it is, and then you can dig into it a little bit deeper. And so then the presenters will be, we're doing one of those each month in 2019. And VIPs and Platinums, they get it as part of their membership. And then if you're like, okay, well, that's cool, but I don't know if I want to join yet or I'm not sure, you can just buy that one presentation. So if Dr. Christina does, if you, whatever you do, then people could just buy that one presentation of you, because I think it's going to be a very highly requested one.
Great.
Great.
Thank you so much for organizing this. And thank every, I guess the last thing I want to say is I want to thank each one of you for being here and being willing to think outside the box and be committed to your animals and seeing that there's some different approaches that you could try.
Yeah. Amazing. Awesome. Well, let's get you back to your vacation, having fun. Thanks for tuning in. Everybody else, I'm going to get my hand on the center of the screen. And so have a great rest of the week, guys. Merry Christmas to you all and Happy New Year. And as the ongoing joke goes, as we get to this time of year, saying, I guess this is the last call of the year. And next year, the next call, that'll be on January, whatever date is, it's on Wednesday at 1 p.m. I think it's January the 2nd. So stay blessed, stay grateful, stay humble, and stay hungry to keep learning and keep growing. And we'll talk to you guys later.